In the art of diplomacy, Richard Nixon's new approach involves the greatest effort ever to establish a unified worldwide foreign policy. On a trip through Asia, the president outlines a new stance for the United States. To the leaders of the Philippines, Indonesia, Thailand, and other friendly nations, he explains that the United States will be a partner with her allies, will not seek to dominate them, nor solve their problems for them. This is the Nixon doctrine: help friends help themselves. The Nixon doctrine calls for continuing consultation with world leaders, especially on the key issues of trade and money and new relationships with communist countries. The president meets with Britain's Prime Minister Heath in Bermuda. At home, he consults with Canada's Prime Minister Trudeau, Israel's Golda Meir, and Japan's then Prime Minister Sato. He goes to Rome to meet with Pope Paul, and to the Azores to confer with France's President Pompidou. Strong links are forged with allies while making new approaches to countries thought to be adversaries. That aspect of the Nixon foreign policy involves developing new communications with communist countries. In 1969, he goes to Romania. The result is the establishment of a new and constructive relationship. But there is more. The president is already moving on his well-planned course to open the walls of communist China. Peking, February 1972. This is the master move in the president's plan to replace confrontation with negotiation. Premier Zhou Enlai awaits the first American president ever to visit China. The occasion is momentous. It reopens a line of communication closed for almost a quarter of a century. And now, out of these conferences can grow a new era of world peace and international understanding. For the president, the meeting fulfills the need he foresaw in 1968, more than a year before his election. He knew and said then that one of the most urgent tasks facing the next president would be the establishment of a new dialogue with the communist Chinese. At the Great Wall, the president sees one symbol of the gulf to be bridged. Built more than 2,000 years ago and stretching thousands of miles, it is a symbol not only of China's ancient independence, but also of her ancient isolation. Differences rooted in history are overshadowed by the needs of the urgent present. In a meeting with Chairman Mao Zedong, fundamental differences are frankly acknowledged, yet the president remains determined to find a common ground upon which the two nations can build a lasting peace. As the meetings begin to bear fruit, there are agreements which carry substantial hope. The United States and China will expand cultural, educational, and journalistic ties. They will work to begin and broaden trade. Their new lines of communication will be kept open and expanded. They agree that disagreements should be settled without threats of force. Yet the president has no illusions that his visit will wipe out all disagreements overnight. But what is important is that after 23 years, China and the United States are on speaking terms again.
I express my appreciation to my Chinese voice, to Mrs. Chang. I listened to her translation. She got every word right.
The next move in the president's global plan is to improve relations with the Soviet Union. He comes to Moscow with a precisely prepared agenda. It is the first time the Kremlin has ever opened its doors for a president of the United States. Too often, summit conferences have been so general that apparent goodwill was soon wiped out by old disagreements. But in meetings with top Soviet leaders, the president seeks and gets concrete results. To the Soviet leaders, the president says that both sides should recognize that there are fundamental and profound differences between the two nations. But he proposes that they give greater weight to their common interest, a mutual longing for peace and security in the world. They have an opportunity in 1972 to begin a new age in their relationship, an era of spirited but friendly competition. Agreements are worked out for cooperation on the environment, space, and technology. The two nations agree to expand trade, and soon a massive sale of grain from American farms to the Soviet Union is announced. A United States company signs an agreement to provide technical assistance to several Soviet industries and to explore for oil and gas in Siberia. While other agreements have far-reaching effects, President Nixon knows that one area carries a direct benefit for the United States economy. New industrial ties can result in 3 million additional jobs for American workers. The most important agreement of all can affect the future of mankind. This is the signing of the Strategic Arms Limitation Treaty, a giant step for peace. The president knows that this does not eliminate every possibility of conflict, and accordingly will keep America's defenses strong. But like his trip to China, the mission to Russia is a journey for peace. On May 28, 1972, the President of the United States prepares to speak to the Russian people. It is a unique moment in history.
Yesterday, I laid a wreath at the cemetery, which commemorates the brave people who died during the siege of Leningrad in World War II. At the cemetery, I saw the picture of a 12-year-old girl. She was a beautiful child. Her name was Tanya. The pages of her diary tell the terrible story of war. In the simple words of a child, she wrote of the deaths of the members of her family. And then finally, these words, the last words in her diary: all are dead. Only Tanya is left. As we work toward a more peaceful world, let us think of Tanya and of the other Tanyas and their brothers and sisters everywhere. Let us do all that we can to ensure that no other children will have to endure what Tanya did, and that your children and ours, all the children of the world, can live their full lives together in friendship and in peace. Спасибо и до свидания.
An encouraged nation welcomes the president home from his journeys. Richard Nixon came to the presidency with a plan to bring order out of the chaos he inherited. And he's getting the job done. With his immense energy, skill, and experience, he is changing the government's role in the country and the country's role in the world. Yet he knows he has not solved all the nation's problems, that much remains to be done. And to lead a great nation forward to new greatness, America needs President Nixon, now more than ever.